What are the things we value most about our modern world? Freedom. To enjoy ourselves. To argue and discuss. To express our views. To find things out. To read and write. And the science and technologies that make these possible. None of this happened by accident. These freedoms were won through courage and with vision in an extraordinary period of human history. It began in 17th century Europe. It was called the Age of Enlightenment. In the space of little more than a century, religious faith yielded to reasoned argument. And the power of aristocracy gave way to the power of knowledge. But it was a hard-won battle against the fierce opposition of a powerful church and ruthless monarchs. It laid the foundations for the modern world. In this program, we tell the story of four great Enlightenment innovators. Isaac Newton, who opened up knowledge to everybody by inventing modern science. Denis Diderot, who challenged the church's monopoly on knowledge. The Marquis de Pombal, who built a modern city for the people of Lisbon. And Erasmus Darwin, whose discoveries deep underground mounted a direct challenge to the church's claim to truth. Our story of the Enlightenment begins in England in the late 17th century with Isaac Newton. He was the founder of modern science, which was to become the single greatest challenge to the power of the church. At the beginning of this period, most people's lives were based on obedience and belief. They obeyed the church, which told them to obey the king, who, it said, had been chosen by God. People believed what was in the Bible, not what they found out for themselves. And the Bible said that the earth and everything on it had been made by God only a few thousand years earlier, and that the first humans had been thrown out of paradise for disobeying God's word. But Isaac Newton declared that knowledge was acquired not by blind faith, but by observation. And that it could be found not just in the Bible, but in the world around us. He laid down universal rules for what we now call science. And one of those rules was that it was open to everybody.
There's one thing that everybody knows about Isaac Newton, that was that he watched an apple fall to the ground, and in a great flash of inspiration, he suddenly conceived the theory of gravity. And we can never know if that really happened or not, but what we do know is that shortly before he died, he told the same story to four different people. And that suggests that he wanted people to believe that it was true. And he sat in the orchard and he sat beneath this apple tree and he watched an apple fall off the tree to the ground. Something he'd seen hundreds of times before, but this time was different. He thought to himself, why is it that the apple always falls down? Why doesn't it go sideways or upwards?
Newton's genius was to see things where most people would see nothing. Instead of empty space between the apple and the ground, Newton saw an active force pulling things towards the earth, the force of gravity.
Newton said there's one single force, the power of gravity, that makes apples fall off the tree in Woolsthorpe Garden, makes the moon go round the earth, and makes the earth go round the sun.
Newton had discovered a vast and universal law. But at this stage of his life, in his 20s, he didn't seem to care if anybody else knew about it. He wrote up his discoveries in Latin, in this book almost nobody could understand. And he buried himself away at Cambridge University.
He seems, as far as we can make out, to have been a very withdrawn, difficult, prickly man. He was an absolutely appalling lecturer. Some students saw him going by in the street and said, "There goes the man who lectures to the walls," by which he meant that there was nobody in the room at all when Newton was lecturing.
But Newton's discovery that what happened in nature followed invisible rules, and that those rules operated everywhere, was too powerful to be hidden in a book.
Newton himself didn't have the slightest interest in whether anybody else could understand how gravity works, but the people who followed him during the 18th century did. And one of the ways of explaining this was instruments like this one in front of me, this orrery. The sun is in the middle, and then there's the five planets, and the time it takes them in this machine to go around the sun is exactly the same proportions of time as they do up in the heavens. Lecturers used to take instruments like this, orreries, and go round to different parts of the country lecturing about Newton's gravity, about the laws of mechanics.
These demonstrations even became the subject of paintings.
This painting is quite literally the Enlightenment in a nutshell. There's a mixed group of people here, men, women, and children. And they're all gathered around this apparatus to witness the workings of the solar system. There is a green drape in the top corner, drawn away from a shelf of books, revealing written knowledge, the word. And the tension in the Enlightenment period itself is beautifully played out by the contrast of light and dark. On the one hand, light, which reveals truth, reveals knowledge. On the other hand, the very deep shadow of darkness. And there's a mystery about this darkness. It conceals. It doesn't quite tell us everything that we need to know about the world in which we live.
But the idea everybody could understand was a universal law that kept everything in its proper place. It was even taught to school children by getting them to act out the orbiting planets in the playground. Parallels were drawn with human society, in which rich and poor had their proper places. Like most people at the time, Newton, who was deeply religious, believed that God had set the planets in motion, and that the whole universe was eternal and changeless. Even though his ideas were not found in the Bible, the church endorsed this apparent proof of God's wisdom. Newton was asking questions about the world around him, but he wasn't alone. He was a founding member of the Royal Society, the world's first scientific association, dedicated to spreading the discoveries of the Enlightenment. Its members believed in the truth of the Bible, but they no longer accepted that it was the only truth.
Traditionally, the way to find out about God was to read the Bible. This was the book of God's holy word that he dictated to Adam. But Newton and his contemporaries said there's a second book that we can learn from, the book of nature, and God has written that book in a different alphabet, and our job is to learn how to read that alphabet. And it was this book of nature that Newton and his contemporaries started to explore.
Using new, more powerful microscopes and telescopes that they designed themselves, these men were opening up an entirely new dimension to the world. Thank you. Over the course of his life, Newton seems to have changed his mind about the importance of publicising his work. His other great experiment is remembered not just for what he found out, but for what he did with the discovery. Back at his boyhood home in 1666, he began to wonder where the colours in the spectrum come from.
Every year, a fair came to Stourbridge in Cambridge, and one year, Isaac Newton went along, and he bought a prism. The prisms were being sold for children to use as toys. People knew that when you throw light through a prism, it makes a spectrum. But Newton wanted to do something different.
He wanted to know if the colours were already in the light or were put there by the prism.
He made his room completely dark. He just had a little teeny ray of sunlight coming through, and he passed the ray of light through the prism and produced the rainbow on the opposite wall, a spectrum.
He then isolated the red light from that spectrum and passed it through a second prism, and the light coming out was still red. He'd proved that the colours came not from the prism, but the light itself. But that wasn't what mattered most. Newton had performed his experiment using a child's toy, something anybody could buy. And having done the experiment, Newton made this sketch of it.
So this is Newton's original sketch. And then this diagram was published in English, in his book, The Optics. In the past, you had to be a very specialised scholar in order to understand what was in the Bible or what was in some esoteric Latin text. But an experiment like this could be repeated anywhere in the world. This was a new source of truth, a new source of knowledge. So ordinary people could use these scientific results to invent things, to make machines, to change the world, to control the world. So the people who understood and who were clever would take over from the people who'd been born into rich, aristocratic, wealthy families. So one of the very, very important things about the Enlightenment, as symbolised by experiments like this, is it's not just about what knowledge was gained, it's about who controls the knowledge.
Newton had established for the first time the scientific method, how all science is carried out to this day, that experiments must be published and must be able to be repeated anywhere in the world. 70 years later, the discoveries of science were to mount a direct and fundamental challenge to the church's authority. But at the time, the church believed that Newton's work endorsed God's power, and he was buried with great ceremony in Westminster Abbey, where England honours its heroes. Newton's funeral was thronged with admirers, including this man, Voltaire. He was the most fearless and prolific thinker and writer in France, a country which at the time brutally repressed any freedom of thought or expression.
Il a traversé tout le siècle des Lumières comme un véritable météore. Et c'est aussi et surtout l'homme qui a inventé la figure de l'intellectuel, c'est-à-dire de l'écrivain engagé dans tous les combats de son temps pour défendre la veuve, l'orphelin et toutes les victimes des crimes et horreurs judiciaires perpétrés par des régimes autoritaires.
Voltaire's crusades forced him to spend most of his life in exile, which is why he was in England. Newton's state funeral impressed him deeply. In France, only aristocrats were honored in this way, and scientific investigation was strictly controlled by an intolerant Catholic Church.
Le plus grand combat de Voltaire, c'est incontestablement le combat pour la tolérance, et en particulier pour la tolérance religieuse. Il était horrifié par le fanatisme qui sévissait à son époque, et ce qu'il a trouvé en Angleterre, c'est un climat de tolérance religieuse, où les différentes chapelles, les différentes confessions pouvaient coexister sans conflit, sans guerre. Une formule de ses lettres philosophiques résume admirablement cette tolérance qu'il a rencontrée en Angleterre. « S'il n'y avait en Angleterre qu'une religion, son despotisme serait à craindre. S'il n'y en avait que deux, elle se couperait la gorge. Mais il y en a 30 et elles vivent en paix et heureuses. »
And this was only one of the freedoms Voltaire found in England. 40 years earlier, Britain's absolute monarchy had been forced by its people to concede some elements of democracy and political representation.
Depuis le Bill of Rights de 1689, la séparation des pouvoirs exécutif, législatif et judiciaire était consacrée en Angleterre.
The king's powers were limited by parliament, judges and civil servants.
Le roi ne pouvait lever d'impôts, édicter de lois, ni faire la guerre sans un vote du Parlement. Et ce régime dans lequel les trois pouvoirs s'équilibraient était évidemment favorable à la liberté, beaucoup plus favorable que le modèle absolutiste français dans lequel le roi exerçait la totalité des pouvoirs.
In England, Voltaire also found the freedom that to him was the greatest of all.
De toutes les autres libertés, Voltaire l'a bien vu, la meilleure arme que l'esprit aille contre la tyrannie, c'est la plume. En instaurant la liberté d'expression, on ouvre un espace public de débat contradictoire, un espace où la nation tout entière peut confronter ses idées, suggérer des réformes, proposer des améliorations du gouvernement. Et c'est en conquérant la liberté d'expression qu'on pourra conquérir les autres libertés.
Voltaire dedicated the rest of his life to the crusade for freedom of speech and of the pen in 20,000 letters and dozens of novels and plays. But all of this could only be dreamed of in the France of Voltaire's day. Here, subversive ideas about equality, liberty and freedom of speech had to be exchanged behind closed doors, in salons like the one shown here, where the bust of Voltaire, as usual still in exile, was honored with pride of place.
Frankreich im 18. Jahrhundert war das, was wir heute ein repressives Regime nennen würden. Und tatsächlich Menschen, die etwas diskutieren wollten, die Ideen diskutieren wollten, die vom Staat nicht sanktioniert waren, mussten zu so einem Ort kommen wie diesem, zu einem Salon. Voltaire hat seine Karriere in so einem Salon begonnen und dort haben sie neue Ideen, Ideen von einer unglaublichen Radikalität diskutiert und entworfen und haben tatsächlich eine ganz neue Weltordnung geplant.
Despite its repressive laws, Paris was becoming a prosperous and exciting city, a magnet for ambitious young men from the provinces, hoping to succeed by their wits. One of them was this man, Denis Diderot. Unlike Voltaire, Diderot wasn't a member of the aristocratic elite. His great work was France's first encyclopedia, the engine of the Enlightenment. But he'd barely begun when another of his works was noticed by the king's censors.
»1749 fand sich Diderot in einer Zelle im Château de Vincennes, vielleicht in dieser. Er hatte es gewagt, ein Buch zu schreiben, in dem er behauptete, Wissen käme von den Sinnen, nicht aus göttlicher Offenbarung. Für den König war das Provokation genug, um ihn hier festzusetzen.« Obwohl Diderot im Hochsommer festgenommen wurde, brachte ihm sein Kerkermeister jeden Tag zwei Kerzen. Nach einigen Tagen sagte er dem Kerkermeister, er könne sie wieder mitnehmen, er brauche das nicht, das Licht sei gut, es sei Sommer. Aber der Kerkermeister sagte ihm, behalte sie, du wirst sie vielleicht während der langen Winterabende brauchen. Erst da wurde ihm klar, dass er hier vielleicht saß für Monate, Jahre, je nachdem, wie lange der König ihn behalten wollte.
But the worst thing about imprisonment for Diderot was that it was keeping him from the great project of his life, the Encyclopédie, which he'd barely begun when he was thrown into jail. His idea was to bring together the finest minds of the day and produce a series of books that would include not only philosophy and ideas, but also craft and trade skills, explained in every detail. Until then, useful knowledge like this hadn't been thought worth recording. But Diderot and his colleagues sought out the ordinary people to whom nobody had previously listened.
Die Behandlung der handwerklichen Tätigkeiten selbst war ein Programm der Enzyklopädie. Es hat die Handwerker sehr aufgewertet in einer Zeit, in der eigentlich nur Aristokraten einen Wert hatten. Und das kommt natürlich auch daher, Diderot kam aus Langres, also eigentlich aus der Provinz, aus der Champagne. Und da war sein Vater ein Messerschmied, er hat Klingen geschmiedet und war sehr gut in seinem Beruf, wollte eigentlich auch, dass sein Sohn ihm nachfolgt. Aber er hat es eine Woche lang probiert und er hat es wirklich nicht gewollt und er hat es wirklich nicht gekonnt. Aber er war stolz auf seinen Vater. Er war stolz auf das Handwerk, er war stolz darauf, dass jemand etwas mit seinen Händen produzierte. Und das ist natürlich auch genau das Gegenteil von den Priestern und Aristokraten, die Frankreich tatsächlich beherrschten.
Even imprisonment didn't discourage Diderot as he planned his encyclopédie, nor did it tone down his radical intentions. But he realized it would outrage the authorities, especially the church.
Sie durften nicht zu subversiv sein. Man muss sich erinnern, damals wurden Menschen nicht nur eingesperrt für das, was sie sagten, sie wurden tatsächlich auch noch hingerichtet, manchmal wahnsinnig grausam hingerichtet.
With the stakes this high, Diderot had to be ingenious in outwitting the censors.
Hier zum Beispiel ist das System de Connaissance, also eigentlich das System des ganzen Wissens. Und wenn Sie sich das ansehen, dann sehen Sie, ganz oben ist die Theologie. Das haben die Zensoren sicherlich gemocht.
But right below religion is black magic. Even the sequence of entries in his encyclopédie held hidden meaning. His world had no place for belief in any god at all. He hid his attacks on the church throughout the whole work, even in a system of cross-references, like one which links the Eucharist with cannibalism. His wit and daring attracted friends as well as enemies. And luckily for Diderot, they included the king's mistress, Madame de Pompadour. She was even painted with her own copy of the Encyclopédie. With such friends in high places, after 3 months in prison, Diderot was released. The king and the censors had realized that Diderot's great project had become an industry in itself, and potentially a very profitable one. Despite continuing harassment from the church, Diderot and his colleagues were consumed for the next 26 years in bringing their great work into being. There were 20 million words in 28 volumes. And every letter of every word had to be set by hand. Hundreds of typesetters, tanners, printers, and bookbinders were involved.
Diderot hatte einen hohen Preis bezahlt für seine Arbeit an der Enzyklopädie. Er war 3 Monate eingesperrt gewesen, aber in 1751 konnte er sie endlich in seinen Händen halten. Da war der Dom Premier und Es war ein gigantischer Erfolg. Und tatsächlich, einerseits seine Inhaftierung und andererseits die Enzyklopädie selbst machten ihn zu einem berühmten Mann, erreichten also das, was er wollte. Er bekam einen Brief von Voltaire, der ihm gratulierte, der ihn den modernen Sokrates nannte.
Diderot's vast enterprise finally achieved his ambition, bringing respect and recognition to ordinary people. But most of them had little chance of reading about it.
The Encyclopédie was a very expensive book. It actually cost something like 980 livres, which, if you put that into the context of the time, a skilled artisan, if he was lucky, might earn something like 15 livres in a week. So he could never have afforded this. It was mostly bought by members of the social elite, the crème de la crème.
And even for those who could, buying any book remained a risky business.
Something like half the books that were published in France during the 18th century were banned books. They were sold under the counter secretly. And even the Encyclopédie was banned for a number of years. But Diderot said, a book banned is a book read.
Diderot realized that the controversy was helping to publicize the Encyclopédie. And despite the risks, its success started a huge boom in publishing at the time. The excitement of access to ideas, to information, to the wider world consumed society at all levels, as even ordinary people learned to read. Diderot's great dream of giving all knowledge to the world was becoming reality. But the church was fighting back. Its supreme leader, the Pope, condemned the Encyclopédie and ordered it burned. He declared that any Catholic who dared to read it would face eternal damnation. Nowhere was the fight between enlightenment and religion harder than in Portugal. Here, the Enlightenment only prevailed through an unforeseeable event, a disaster which devastated the wealthy capital and whose wider effects were to threaten the Church's authority throughout the world, right up to today. In the mid-18th century, Portugal was still the most religious place in Europe. Enlightenment ideas were barely known here. Even more than in France, the Catholic Church was in control. The priests told the people that sinners would be horribly punished by God after death. And a religious court called the Inquisition could condemn people to garrotting, beheading, or being burnt alive. It seemed that nothing could change the order of things, until one day in November 1755. The capital city, Lisbon, was mostly made up of narrow, crowded streets, all higgledy-piggledy on the shores of a big river. It teemed with a population of 250,000 people.
O dia 1 de novembro é um dia de Todos os Santos e é um dia feriado que naturalmente tem um especial significado nos países católicos. Portanto, no dia 1 de novembro de 1755, de manhã, toda a população de Lisboa acorria naturalmente às inúmeras igrejas e espaços religiosos. Perto das 10 da manhã, uma coisa terrível aconteceu e completamente inesperada. Ouviu-se um barulho tremendo e de repente as pessoas perceberam que a cidade estava a ruir à volta delas.
Lisbon was being struck by a massive earthquake.
E o terremoto atingiu uma escala de cerca de 9.1 na escala de Richter, desabou sobre Lisboa e, naturalmente, teve efeitos de uma destruição e de uma violência muitíssimo grandes.
As the city collapsed around them, some managed to escape the churches, only to be crushed in the streets by other falling buildings. Those who survived fled for their lives towards the river, only to see a huge tsunami bearing down on them. They drowned where they were. Then a wildfire swept through the city, adding to the carnage. Tens of thousands of people died that day. The people of Lisbon had done what the priests told them to. They had gone to church, they had prayed. But dreadful punishment had rained down on them anyway. They wanted to know why.
A igreja dificilmente encontrava uma explicação lógica para que um Deus bom e omnipotente tivesse permitido que esta catástrofe acontecesse em Lisboa. Mas, efetivamente, a única coisa que a Igreja acabou por poder dizer era aconselhar as pessoas a rezar a Deus, a um Deus que tinha causado esta catástrofe.
One priest in particular rallied the people to repent, telling them that God had sent the earthquake, fire and tsunami as punishment for their sinfulness.
Gabriel Malagrida era um padre jesuíta de origem italiana que se tinha já destacado e tinha adquirido uma espécie de estatuto místico como pregador na cidade de Lisboa. As suas pregações eram particularmente importantes e ouvidas com muita atenção. E convidava as pessoas apenas a rezar e não a ajudarem nos esforços de reconstrução da cidade.
But there were no churches to pray in. Most of them had been destroyed too. The earthquake also destroyed the faith of people hundreds of miles away. The church's inability to explain any of this sent shockwaves all over Europe. But there was one man who saw an opportunity in this disaster. The Marquis de Pombal was one of the few Portuguese who'd had access to the new ideas of the Enlightenment. Here at his once grand estate outside Lisbon, he began to plan to use these ideas to change the city and the lives of its people forever. For him, the earthquake was a chance to put those ideas into practice for the benefit of the whole population.
O Marquês de Pombal foi uma figura especial no nosso século XVIII. Tinha sido ministro plenipotenciário, portanto, embaixador, primeiro em Londres e depois em Viena da Áustria. E essa experiência nessas duas capitais, num momento em que justamente a sociedade europeia estava a mudar, deu-lhe uma visão diferente daquilo que podia ser o futuro para Portugal.
Pombal wanted not just to rebuild the city, but to reinvent it. He had a vision of doing in stone and tile what Diderot had done in print, to bring the ordinary people into the Enlightenment and reduce the privilege of church and aristocracy. Pombal was the king's right-hand man, not an atheist like Diderot, nor a commoner like Newton. His plan was to use the king's power to get access to the church's wealth, not for himself, but for the people. But he faced a formidable challenge. The church and the king monopolized the power here, and the wealth from Portugal's huge empire. The enormous palace and monastery of Mafra, outside Lisbon, has almost 900 rooms and took 45,000 men 13 years to build.
Mafra é bom exemplo desta partilha de poder entre o rei e a igreja. Por lado temos o Paço Real, onde o rei ficava, e do outro lado uma igreja, convento, onde justamente os monges podiam rezar.
The monks also told the people to pray and what to pray for.
Assim, por lado, o rei considerava que vivia numa monarquia de origem divina e que, portanto, o seu poder tinha origem em Deus. Por outro lado, a igreja garantia uma solução de proximidade relativamente às populações e que o povo obedecia essa autoridade.
The monks who lived here enjoyed every luxury. Ate off tables made from rare hardwoods cut by slaves. And walked on marble floors. Far from Lisbon, their monastery was untouched by the earthquake. Meanwhile, the people, always poor, were now homeless and starving. Pombal needed money to feed and house them. He persuaded the king that funding the rebuilding and modernizing of Lisbon would earn real loyalty from his people. He also realized that the skills he needed to build it were already at hand. The proof was in this aqueduct that brought fresh water from 60 kilometers away and stored it for the city. And it had withstood the earthquake.
Foi graças às suas águas que foi possível acorrer a duas necessidades imediatas. Foi possível prover as necessidades de água potável e também para combater o fogo que, como vimos, graçou por Lisboa e destruiu uma grande parte da cidade.
To Pombal, the aqueduct represented Newton's science put to practical use to provide a better life for the people. Pombal realized he could use the same skills to rebuild Lisbon. He'd replace the chaotic randomness of the old city with the geometric lines of classical architecture and incorporate the latest technologies. A new sewage system channeled away waste that had once flowed down the streets. The first ever anti-seismic structures protected against future earthquakes. And the urgent need to rehouse the homeless was answered by the world's first standardized building components. Every window, frame and balcony the same, so they could be made in quantity. He gave the city to the people of Lisbon for their own, a beautiful public place that belonged not to the church or the aristocracy, but to them. The success of Pombal's huge rebuilding project undermined the church's power over the people. And Pombal had insulted the church directly by replacing the ruined churches with structures that looked like all the other buildings. The church's leaders were outraged, and the Jesuit Gabriel Malagrida became the rallying point for their opposition to Pombal. Malagrida embarked on a campaign of furious propaganda against Pombal, writing pamphlets and sending scores of letters to powerful Catholics all over Europe, including the church's ultimate leader, the Pope. Pombal was alarmed. He could not afford to risk the church regaining its former power. Confident by now of the king's support and gratitude, he took a bold step. He decided to make an example of Malagrida for a supposed blasphemy and have him executed.
Gabriel Malagrida, direta ou indiretamente, tinha causado a morte a tantas pessoas, foi afinal eliminado da mesma maneira, de uma maneira também ela violenta e também ela muitíssimo controversa.
Malagrida was garrotted and his body burned to ashes. Then Pombal ended the Inquisition forever. Now, Pombal was finally able to bring to Portugal the wisdom of the Enlightenment. This beautiful room in the monastery at Mafra was transformed into a library, full of the revolutionary thinking that had never been allowed before. Pombal had used the power of an absolute monarch to bring the Enlightenment to Portugal. He'd built the most modern city in the world and freed people from their terror of the church. Meanwhile, in England, the technology embraced by Pombal was already moving the world towards industrial revolution. It began here in the centre of England, in Derbyshire, where the hills concealed a unique treasure trove of the valuable minerals needed for industry, and fast-flowing rivers provided power. In 1721, in the quiet town of Derby, the world's first factory was built, a silk mill. Mass production in factories would make it possible for anybody to become rich. The Enlightenment triumph of meritocracy over aristocracy was already well underway. Erasmus Darwin, grandfather of Charles Darwin, was right at the heart of it. Born 4 years after Newton's death, he was a doctor, poet, philosopher, and inventor. Darwin's wide-ranging interests would inspire him to mount the Enlightenment's ultimate challenge to the authority of the Church. He was fascinated by Enlightenment thinking and its application to real life.
Erasmus Darwin was a member of an entirely new class, optimistic, passionate, aggressive, and living by their wits. They hadn't inherited money, they had to make their living for themselves. For Darwin, the key was to understand, manage, and direct the rapidly changing world around him.
Darwin's friends were leading lights in natural philosophy, innovation, and industry. Inspired by them, Darwin recorded his own ideas and inventions in this book.
It's an amazing window through which we can see what drove him and what he cared about. These are some drawings that Darwin made of the new weaving machines, which completely transformed the English textile industry. He isn't just recording what he sees. He's also trying to work out ways of making them more efficient. Here we have a new kind of toilet, one which, as Darwin notes, won't be annoying because it won't smell.
For Darwin, as for Pombal, Enlightenment thinking was fundamentally about progress.
For Darwin and his closest allies, what was happening in Britain promised everything. A massive improvement in welfare, in population, and above all, I think, in the contentment and happiness of the people.
Mm-hmm. Darwin's work as a doctor required him to travel long distances to visit patients. And on one of these journeys, his contacts in industry gave him the chance to make his greatest discovery.
This may look like a rural landscape, but in Darwin's day, it was a region of heavy industry. This was where quarrymen and miners dug deep underground through natural caverns to bring out minerals and chemicals that were then going to be used in the industries that Darwin's friends were running, in pottery, in textiles, industries that were driving the industrialization of Britain.
Caverns like this gave Darwin a chance to investigate the biggest of all questions: how the Earth itself and everything on it was made. The Lisbon earthquake and a series of volcanic eruptions after it, including this one at Vesuvius in Italy, had started a worldwide controversy over the Bible's account of creation. If the church's most important story wasn't true, then its entire claim to authority was in doubt. And Darwin, a religious skeptic, seized on his chance to gather evidence for himself. To get into this deep cavern, he had to be lowered on a rope down a shaft, a perilous enterprise.
Darwin was fascinated by the mineral forms he found deep inside these caves. But what interested him the most were the chemical processes that must be producing them. Limestone, heat, water, a kind of laboratory of nature. And then Darwin discovered something even more amazing, because here, in the walls of the cavern, were fossilized shells that looked exactly like creatures that live at the bottom of the sea. And that posed Darwin a great question. How could these creatures have ended up here, deep beneath the Earth's surface?
Darwin realized this could only have happened if the Earth were in constant motion and millions of years old, far older than the Bible had claimed, and that it must once have been entirely covered by oceans. But Darwin was interested not just in how the creatures had got here, but how they and all life had begun. Another of his scientific observations gave him the next piece of the puzzle.
This is Darwin's own microscope, itself a new piece of apparatus in the 18th century, and Darwin noticed something quite extraordinary. By looking at small dead insects beneath a slide, he saw bacteria multiplying, something which had never been seen before. It was multiplying without any outside help, and it seemed as though life was making itself.
If life could come about in a warm room, thought Darwin, it could also have happened in the warm oceans. Darwin put all this together with his belief that things constantly change for the better and wrote an explosive theory of the origins of all life. 70 years before the famous work of his grandson, Charles Darwin.
Here's his description of that great process. Would it be too bold to imagine, perhaps millions of ages before the commencement of the history of mankind, that all warm-blooded animals have arisen from one living filament, possessing the faculty of continuing to improve by its own inherent activity and of delivering down those improvements by generation to its posterity, world without end.
Erasmus Darwin's theory of the origins of life in effect declared that everything the Church had asked the entire Christian world to believe about how God had made the earth and everything in it was simply untrue. Darwin had used science to challenge its greatest enemy in unarguable terms. The Church would never fully recover from Darwin's attack. From Newton to Darwin, science was displacing God from an active role in the universe and moving man towards the centre. The Enlightenment had flooded the Western world with books full of new ideas of freedom, progress, and reason. It had declared war on the power and authority of the Church and deployed new technologies to improve the lives of ordinary people. But absolute monarchies and rich elites were still in control. The next program will tell the stories of three men who tried to change the societies in which they lived by putting Enlightenment ideas into practice. Through their efforts, the organization of government, the rights of individuals, and the structure of society itself would be changed forever.